Okay, Matthew, we have to have one agreement now. Next time we do this, we need to update those pictures.
That's it, yeah.
I feel like that's my high school picture.
They're pretty big.
I don't look anything like that anymore.
The big pictures. The big. So how's it going? That was quite a sizzle reel we just saw.
It'd be nice if I could just, the intro's great, the tape was great. If we can just, now we can just take questions from the audience.
Yeah, terrific.
No, things are going terrific. You know, we've, fortunately we've come up with a really terrific year. You know, if you think of our business, it's kind of in three buckets. We have our production business, our channels business, and our distribution business. So just quickly, in our production business, we've had a sensational year. At the Emmy Awards this year, we kind of swept all the awards with Breaking Bad. Shark Tank swept on the reality side, so very happy about that. It's great when you have a nice show like the Breaking Bad, then to go right into a Blacklist. And Blacklist got off to a great start this year on NBC, and it's probably around the world one of the most watched shows in the world. And it's just a terrific show, and we're very pleased with that. Our other U.S. show, The Goldbergs, off to a great start on ABC. And we really had a great summer with some new original shows. Outlander did very well on Stars. Got renewed for a second season. Masters of Sex continued to do well. Mm-hmm. And that was picked up for a third season. And we just have so much great stuff in the pipeline now. I was just down the set of Better Call Saul.
Right.
And I keep bumping into people who say, I need my Breaking Bad fix.
Yeah, this is it.
And Bob Odenkirk is doing a terrific job, and so we're very excited about that. Mm-hmm. And I also, when I get off the plane, and we can talk more about this later, got a great response at New York Comic Con for Powers,
right,
which is our PlayStation original program. Mm-hmm. So that's U.S. production. Our international production business, we have 15 production companies in 10 countries. Mm-hmm. We're having a very good year. There's a big announcement, hopefully, to come in the near future on a show we're doing. Details are about to be wrapped up, but I think it's going to be very big on a global scale. This past year, we made an output deal with Televisa, mm-hmm, which is very exciting. On the distribution side, you know, here at this market, it's just amazing what's going on because of the digital explosion. We pretty much doubled the number of buyers we have around the world because, right, of the additional platforms. That's also very exciting. We're doing business in China right now, and hopefully that continues. Mm-hmm. And on our channel side, you know, we have 168 feeds around the world. And when people think of us, they don't think of us, the United States, as a channels business.
Right.
Even though we have Crackle, which we can talk more about later, and the Game Show Network, we're really thought of much more as an international channels business, and we're, you know, very big in India, Europe. We just bought the CSC Group, which is another 16 channels to our portfolio, mm-hmm, Latin America, Japan, and so across all businesses right now, knock on wood, you know, things are pretty good.
So
not perfect, and we still got our heads banged around a little bit, but doing pretty good.
There's plenty going on. So the production,
yes,
distribution,
and channels.
And where do you guys fit in, do you think? I mean, you've got a media landscape which is kind of consolidating, especially on,
right,
the distribution side in the U.S. Where does Sony Pictures TV fit in?
What's really interesting is, I think when people think of Sony, they think of this big company, this, mm-hmm, big multinational company, which it is. But on the television side, we're a pretty lean, mean operation. I think in the scheme of things, there's a lot of consolidation going on in the world, which I think is great. But I think what we found, particularly, you look at the United States as an example, our independence has really worked as a benefit to us. So, you know, I remember going to conferences and people saying, well, you can't, and this goes back 10, 11 years ago, we had one show on the air.
Right.
And people said, in the U.S., and people say, well, you can't really exist. You can't exist as a standalone production company
without a network.
Without a network. Yeah. You can't, yeah, do it. Today, we have around 30 original shows on the air with 14 different networks. And what's appealing about that is, for the people we go out and hire, whether it's Vince Gilligan or David Shore, Peter Tolan, whoever we're in business with, they like the ability to go sell to everybody.
Yeah.
So we've taken full advantage of that. And I think internationally, being a lean, mean, aggressive company really works to our benefit. And great ideas don't come from necessarily being part of a big production organization. Mm-hmm. It just takes, I'm always amazed, John DeMaul, that, the voice comes from, come from one small group of people. Or, we have a number of great ideas coming up through our international production business, which come from really smart, creative development people. Mm-hmm. And so we think we can maneuver and be very nimble in a world that's becoming very consolidated. And I also think with consolidation, there comes a lot of headaches in terms of putting that all together. So,
So your independence can be
we think is a positive. Yes.
So in this kind of global, there are more opportunities now for a leaner, independent company like yourselves globally, but there are also risks. I mean, piracy, you and I have talked about before, is a big issue. What do you feel about that?
I tell you, I do think a lot of people in the television business have been in denial about piracy for a while. And if you look at the motion picture business, when a movie comes out for a weekend, I think immediately look at how many, whether it's been pirated or not, they look immediately at, did it affect the box office in territories, United States? With piracy in television, it's a little bit more of a slow burn. And Keith LeGoy, who oversees our international distribution business, really brought it to my attention. And we kind of have this phrase within the company that if we don't do something about piracy, not only will our business be worth less, it'll be worthless.
Right.
Because by the time it gets to our international market, it'll be up on pirated sites and be seen by a lot of people. So we've done a couple things. And I think the real eye-opener for us was when Breaking Bad came out with its final episode. And we were very concerned about whether that would get out.
Yeah.
So we called everybody in, I'll never forget, my office, and basically tried to find out, where the show went from the time we finished shooting the final episode to the time it was distributed on channels around the world. Mm-hmm. And it was startling to me because it's hundreds of people, they're dubbing or subtitling, color, whatever it is, that were touching the show. In the case of Breaking Bad, this episode we were trying to keep under wraps. So I'm a big believer you can't wave your finger at the pirates and say, shame on you.
Yeah.
We've got to do our homework and we have to do our job. So the first thing we did is really instill some very tight controls within our company in terms of what vendors we use and who touches the show and where we do our subtitling, where we do our dubbing, and really protect the product from the time it leaves our hands and gets out to our channels around the world. That's the first thing. From a business solution standpoint, what we thought is the more you make the product available, the sooner you make it available in markets as close to the U.S. airing as possible, the more you'll deter the pirates.
So in other words, more of a day and date.
Right, so we're moving, and it's not easy, but we're trying to get to a place where we go day and date as much as possible around the world. And you look at, Netflix are doing a lot of global buying. I think, ironically, that's one way it could deter piracy. But we're really working hard with our partners around the world and seeing if we can get these shows to air closer to U.S. date. And the other thing I will say, it requires a lot of work on our part production-wise, because shows like The Blacklist, we find ourselves delivering them very close to air.
Right.
And if we really want to do this whole day and date thing, we need to kind of move our production schedule back in a way where we can make sure we properly dub it and subtitle it and get it out to our partners around the world. But I ultimately think that's the solution is in some ways, you're never going to eliminate piracy. You're just not.
Yeah.
And when you see the stat that 11 minutes after an episode starts airing on NBC, it's being sent out somewhere else around the world, you just realize you have a little bit of a problem. We need to do as much as we can to try to minimize it.
Right. So it's a consequence of having global hits that people want
to pirate. It's a nice problem to have.
Right, right. I guess another consequence is that you're now selling your shows to new buyers. I mean, there are new digital buyers around. Now, there might be some tension there between digital buyers and traditional buyers of a TV program. Is that a good or a bad thing for you guys?
I think, over the last, we've seen cycles where how the business has grown. And if you go back over the last 15 years, there was a five-year run going back in the early part of the decade where pay TV was growing. And then after that, it was different types of VOD, and now we're seeing subscription. I do think, and I can say this about ourselves, I think added competition makes everybody better. Mm-hmm. So the answer is yes. I mean, we've seen our buyers increase significantly around the world. in the last 5 years, almost double internationally, which is incredible. But wow. I think what you're seeing, I mean, look, you see what Netflix did in the United States, and it's pretty amazing where they've gone from zero to where they've gone today in terms of subscribers. But I also think that around the world, a lot of very smart people with very big media companies have been very observant as to what's been going on in the United States. Mm-hmm. So what we're seeing in a lot of territories, and whether it's in the UK with Sky or Shaw in Canada, they kind of see it coming. So, you know, they're doing, you know, they're obviously running their business and being very smart about how they handle the over-the-top business. But I just think in a very interesting way, added competition makes everybody better.
Right.
And for us, the upside has been there's more buyers. And I think it's also made people better creatively because there's a lot of great product out there. Mm-hmm. And what drives these platforms, as great as the technology is, what drives the platforms is great content.
Right. This is not to ignore the traditional business. I mean, you guys have a big Seinfeld and syndication, for example, keeps, you know, the...
Pays the bills.
The gift that keeps on giving, isn't
we're,
it?
Someone told me when I took this job, it's great, you're making a lot of new shows, but keep your soap operas on the air around the world, which we've done. Days of Our Lives, Young and Restless. Keep Wheel of Fortune, Jeopardy humming along, and it's two of the most successful shows in the world, and we just... We're actually selling here at MIPCOM Sports Jeopardy, which is a spinoff of our traditional Jeopardy, and keep selling Seinfeld.
Right.
So we're doing all those things.
That's good. Now, you know, Sony TV, your TV business is part of Sony, part of a conglomerate, which has had its problems, and has even recently, I think, took a $2.5 billion.
I haven't read the papers. I heard something about that.
I mean, does that? How does that play into what you guys do and affect what you do?
Yeah, what's really interesting is, I think more than ever, what we do is important to the company, and you can't stick your head in the sand. You can't ignore it. I think Kaz is doing a terrific job running the company, and certainly through some difficult times. All I know is it's incumbent upon us to do a good job what we do, and I can tell you, I've been with the company for 22 years now, and. There's never been a time when the different parts of the company and the entertainment company have worked so closely together. So Doug Morris and Marty Bandier in music, and Andy House at PlayStation, and Amy Pascal, Michael Linton, and, you know, as a team, you know, Tom Rothman's now over, and he's going to be doing some television. Yeah. So, you know, within the company, everybody's working very closely to really maximize all of our assets. If you don't mind, actually... I just saw this on Friday, but there's a clip which I just, and I'll talk about it a little bit afterwards, but we've worked for years. I think Crackle, for example, is a good example of, in the digital space, what we can do as a company in terms of building a channel asset in the digital world. And, you know, we went from years ago running our library product and doing, you know, we used to do mini-sodes, which were kind of, you know, 5-minute versions of hours and half hours of our shows. That was a big thing. To today, where we have a full slate of library pictures, library and television, but we're doing originals with Jerry Seinfeld.
Yeah.
We're doing feature films. We just announced we're doing the sequel to Joe Dirt with David Spade. We're doing an anime show with Bryan Cranston. We're doing Sports Jeopardy on Crackle. Mm-hmm. So it's a great over-the-top offering in the digital space when it comes to the work within the company. But we've also worked hard with PlayStation to try to do original content for them. So on Friday, we premiered the clip of Powers, and it's about a superhero who loses his superpowers.
Mojo,
But if you don't mind, I'll show a quick, it's a quick 60-second clip, so if you can give a clip. Show that.
There was a time when I could fly. I was a hero, above the law. Then I lost my powers, so they gave me a badge. The fuck am I supposed to do with that?
Christian, it's your own fault. They're all dead.
It'll be good to have a real detective around.
See if you can teach him something.
You know, I asked for Powers Division. No cop in the world knows what you know. No one else can teach me how a power thinks.
Being powerful makes you feel like you could save the whole world.
Who's the girl?
The wannabe.
How does it feel, Christian, to be powerless?
Boyle's alive. You're gonna get somebody killed.
It's unlocked.
I'll probably get in trouble with somebody for showing that, but the reason I want to show is because we're doing a big budget TV show for PlayStation.
Right.
And the budgets are comparable to what we're doing with our basic cable dramas. You know, we're working actually with Under Armour CEO Kevin Plank and their people to come up with the cool new look, superhero costumes of the future. Mm-hmm. And it's exciting. I mean, we've been working really hard to work with Andy House for a long time to really make it work, make the model work, and get the right show creatively that is complementary to the existing PlayStation audience.
Right.
And it's been great. I mean, it's we're shooting it in Atlanta right now.
This is a show that you're working with the PlayStation division on?
Yes, directly. Okay. So we're also here at MIPCOM selling it around the world like our traditional shows.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, in the opening clip, we had Vince Gilligan talking about
Right. Golden
age of television. A lot of people are talking about that now. Do you buy into that? Do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think all of us here in the room take great pride being in the TV business. And there was a period of time when I first got started 100 years ago where, you know, at least when I was a kid growing up, you know, the television used to be this little box that sat on a table. It was black and white. You could get a couple of channels. And I think what's important today are a couple of things, but one is the fact that the television experience in the home is phenomenal. You know, the picture quality is great. You know, Sony now is making a big investment in 4K, as are a lot of people, to make the look of our content even better. But, you know, you get a beautiful picture in their home. It sounds great. It's a comfortable setting. And I think that goes a long way to convincing top people to be in the business. But if you look now, I mean, the types of people, you know, from Vince Gilligan to David Fincher to George Clooney to, I mean, anybody who's anybody in the media world is looking to be involved in television. And it used to be when you were in television, or if you were in motion pictures and you did television, there was kind of a, okay, why are they doing television?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And now it's so interchangeable, and not only interchangeable for traditional, but you see, you know, people making, you know, online and you know, just they're doing everything. It's just delivering content regardless of the platform. I mean, the quality is so good and the writing is so good. And look, I'm very partial, but I watch Breaking Bad and I watch Masters of Sex and I watch some of our shows and you watch Homeland and there's some really terrific television. It's well written and well produced and great acting and you know, when I talked to Vince Gilligan about, you know, I said, well, so compare, what do you love about movies and what do you love about television? He's obviously got a great love for motion pictures because he was a screenwriter. But he said, you know, in television, why all these people are coming is the fact that you can grab these characters, whether it's Walter White or whoever, and just over a period of years and episodes, really peel back the layers and dig down deep and and I think the other thing that's been great is that television now, it's global, completely global. And if you look at the casting of whether it's Powers or any of our shows, you know, at least at our place, you know, everything we make is done through the eyes of how is this going to work around the world?
Right.
How are we casting? I mean, James Spader is famous around the world. He just did a press tour through the UK. It was huge for us.
Yeah.
When we did Damages, the reason Damages was so successful is because, you know, Rose Byrne was cast, she's Australian, and Glenn Close, who was a motion picture star, was known around the world. But, you know, everything we do has an eye to how it's going to work around the world. We're constantly looking, you know, we shot Outlander in Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
So we're constantly looking for interesting places to shoot our shows, particularly ones that give tax credits.
Yes.
But
they help.
That helps a lot.
Yeah.
But no, it's look, I feel very proud to be part of the TV industry right now.
Yeah.
And I think at our place, we root for success throughout. Yeah. I mean, it's great, you know, just to see everybody else have success, because it's just great for the business.
What about the sort of, you know, people talk about millennials don't watch TV, and there are these new digital platforms. I mean, we're going to be talking to Maker a little bit after this session, to Enon Christ, but what do you think about the new sort of plethora of digital channels out
so
there?
So I have three kids, one 29, one 20, or 125 and 15. I don't know that they feel an obligation at times to watch when they're told to watch.
Right.
But the beauty of the business is that the way it's set up, whether it's through subscription or through catch up with traditional networks, there's more opportunity to watch program when you want to watch it than ever before. And look, you look at the Nielsen numbers around the world, TV viewing is going up. And it's going up because, I said earlier, the quality of the programming is great. I will put an asterisk on that and say, there's some really tacky, disgusting programming which people like too. Mm-hmm. You know, we all like a good glazed donut every once in a while. I think there's always room for, you know, cheesy TV, which is great too, so.
Right. And you have your own digital platform. You mentioned Crackle.
No, Crackle has been...
Jerry Seinfeld's obviously a big part of that.
No, I mean, like I said, in the U.S., we have Game Show Network, but, you know, Crackle's been just a passionate thing for everybody in the company, and we've seen it grown. It's now 22 countries around the world, and we're attracting some amazing talent, and like I said, we've gone from, you know, I think we're kind of like, and I say this with all respect to John Landgraf and Peter Rice over at Fox, but we're kind of a digital version of FX.
Yeah.
You know, we're trying to be. I think they're a great model where, you know, we've got library programming, whether it's movies or TV shows, and good ones, but we have these tentpole programs, right, original programs, mm-hmm, that really drive the identity and the viewership and the advertising dollars. I mean, the work Jerry Seinfeld's doing with Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee is phenomenal. Mm. And the awards that it's won and the viewership that it's driven, it's just been terrific. You know, we've been working with David Spade for a while to do the sequel to Joe Dirt. We thought it was a great franchise, which fits the audience we have for Crackle, and I think we're looking forward to doing a lot more. And I think on the dramas, we're just attracting a great group of people that really view it as just another platform to, you know, get their great ideas out.
And so, for Breaking Bad junkies like myself and Better Call Saul, just remind us when that's
beginning of next year. Yeah. It's like I said, it was fun watching, going down and visiting the set, and Vince is fully engaged, and Bob Odenkirk is doing a great job. And I think for all the great Breaking Bad fans, there's gonna be a lot of twists and turns. I won't spill the beans too much, but it's gonna wanna force you to go back and check out things that happened in Breaking Bad to make sure you were clear on what you saw back then. So it's exciting. We're looking forward to it.
Terrific. We are sadly out of time, so we'll be back in a few minutes. But in the meantime, please.
Thank you for having me, Matthew.
Steve,
good seeing
Mosko.
You.
A round of applause.
Thank you.
Thanks
Thank
a lot.
You. Thank you.